Thank you very much, dear professors. Thank you for Professor Nesmei, thank you for Professor Taroshi, and last but not least, thank you for Professor Marshai also to be here. I'm very glad for this invitation to hold a lecture about Professor Nesmei has already said the title of my lecture, and I would like to make a small correction about that. Is that, of course, I would like to talk about the MENA region, but since I have 19 minutes, I think, now, so it will be difficult to reach out to all the MENA region and discuss the problems of the MENA region in sense of food security. This is why I will focus in today's speech on Egypt, on the situation in Egypt. So, in my presentation, I analyzed the impact of the Russian-Ukrainian war on agricultural export and food security. It is already clear that a group of the most affected countries are in the Middle East, as they are highly dependent on agricultural imports, especially those coming from Russia and Ukraine. Egypt, the world's largest importer of grain, 60% of its needs are from abroad, are imported to the country. It imports 80% of its wheat from the two belligerents and therefore from those two countries, Russia and Ukraine, and therefore particularly exposed to the negative repercussions of the war. Beyond grain, the Russian-Ukrainian war may also lead to a drop in the export of fertilizers and sunflower oil, which will result in a significant price increase in the market. This situation places an enormous strain on governments and societies in the Middle East, and especially in Egypt. The already significant increase in food prices and the expected food shortages could lead to serious political tensions similar to the so-called Arab Spring, to the period before the Arab Spring, ultimately enhancing the willingness to emigrate from the region. So my presentation will focus on Egypt to show the early signs of the crisis and the measures Cairo takes and would like to take in the future, of course at the governmental level, to prevent unmanageable difficulties. So for this reason, let me start with some very short clues. So we are talking about food security. We all know the definition of food security. I would like to define this in a very short time. Agricultural impacts we have for the war in Ukraine. We have global impacts, as well as the impacts on the export capacities of Russia and Ukraine. I would like, as I said, to focus on Egypt. How was the situation before the war? And what are the current governmental or the future governmental measures? Conclusion, what can be expected? So food security and definitions. The concept of food security is based on three pillars, as all of us know. So that's food availability, accessibility, and stability. Accessibility means the reasonable and affordable prices of basic food communities. This is for Ouda Zahri and Kamal, as we see here is the quotation. So all people, all times, have physical and economic access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that meets their dietary needs. This is the definition of the FAO provided in 2006. So food security determines economic and social stability in any country. This is true for the MENA region countries, of course. Food security is related very thoroughly to national security, and I would like to give an example of what happened in the Arab Spring before 2011. The main problem in Syria, for example, I don't want to talk about Syria that much, the main problem in Syria was the increase of prices of corns and of grains. Because Syria, what Syria did was sold its reserve from corn in 2007 because the prices were very high. They were expecting the prices to drop in the next year, but it didn't. So in 2008, they had to buy grains on a much more higher price, and that continued up till 2010. So one of the major reasons of the unrest that happened in Syria I'm not saying that's the reason, but one of the reasons was the very high prices of food in Syria. So this economic crisis could really lead to political and social unrest in a country, especially in the case of vulnerable countries like those in the MENA region. And of course, the repercussions of the so-called Arab Spring are still there, living in everyday life. If we go from Tunisia to Libya to even Egypt, Syria, so we can see that the impacts of the Arab Spring are still found in these societies and these countries. So two of the largest exports, crop exports, are at war with each other. This is a problem for everyone, but it's especially for those countries which are very dependent on the commodities imported from these two countries. So Russia and Ukraine provide 40% of wheat, 90% of barley, and 4% of maize production globally. These are enormous numbers. So Russia and Ukraine provide these countries together 30% of wheat exports, 20% of maize exports, and 80% of sunflower oil exports globally. So 28%, above all this, 28% of the fertilizers in the world come from Ukraine and Russia, which are essential in other fields of agriculture. The global implications of war, the rise in food prices, even in 2021, with the signs of war being present in the autumn of 2021, where the gas prices and the energy prices started to creep up and up every week. So the food prices started also as well to creep up. I'm not talking about skyrocketing. They started to skyrocket now after the war, but the prices were increasing slowly, but were increasing since September 2021. Now we have the highest prices ever, food prices ever. Higher prices of fertilizers due to the natural gas price hike. Yes, these are, of course, related to the increase of energy prices. Growing oil and gas prices, it also caused the increase of the transport expense of all the goods. So as an example, the container, one container of commodities, for example, from China to Egypt, to the Middle East, is quadrupled, the price of the transportation, which is not a negligible issue. Agricultural exports of Ukraine. Ukraine is expected to use right now 70-80% of the land for agricultural production this year. It means due to the war, it lost about 20-30% of its eligible land, which is not that bad. Experts expected Ukraine to lose half of its lands, cultivated lands, because of the war, but it didn't happen. Right now, it's about 20-30% loss. Ukrainian exports are problematic as well. Before the reasons are here, because of the we know the reason, because of the ports are closed. Before the war, they had 6 million tons of crops were exported monthly from Ukraine. 95% of wheat and maize exports are through the Black Sea. We know that the Black Sea, the ports are mined, so it's impossible for any ship to leave the port in Ukraine and to take the goods from Ukraine. The Russians are doing that because they are, as well as, according to the Ukrainians, the Russians stole a lot of Ukrainian wheat and selling them to other countries. But that's, I don't know. I have no information about that. The invasion suspended shipping from Ukraine's commercial ports. Odessa is the central hub for exporting wheat. Now there is at least, currently, 25 million tons of crop surplus in Ukraine, which the country cannot export. Also, there are agricultural export problems with Russia. So the problem is that the problem is different in its type, because there is no production problem in Russia. There are no shortages, but the restrictions and the sanctions make it very difficult for any international company or any other country, foreign country, to deal with Russia because of payment problems, financial risks, and let's not forget about the companies, which the insurance companies, which will not make any good insurance prices for any vessel coming out of Ukraine or from Russia. So the insurance prices are very high for anything coming out from Russia and Ukraine. I would like to go straight to the point to talk about Egyptian agriculture before the war. Historically, we know Egypt is a breadbasket, was a breadbasket. So in the past, Egypt was an export of wheat and grains. It was an agricultural exporter, but Egypt has a very big problem, is the demographic boom, which is continuous and steadily continuous. Enormous challenges for Egypt. Climate change, the desertation causes a lot of problems, loss of arable lands, global warming, desertification, land degradation, increasing demands, the population growth, which is the biggest problem in Egypt, and inequality and water scarcity. I would like to add here the Ethiopian Great Renaissance Dam and all the Ethiopian dam systems, which Ethiopia is, I think, planning to implement in the future, to build in the future. So all these problems make the Egyptian leadership facing very real challenges in the sense of keeping the country livable in the future. In 2020, Egypt imported $5.2 billion in wheat primarily from Russia, $3.23 billion, France, $330 million, Ukraine. We see in red, I mark Russia and Ukraine because they are the biggest exports of wheat to Egypt. Land reclamation projects in the Toshka. So what are the, so I would like to talk about this at the end because this will be one of the solutions, in my opinion, the long-term solutions, building more lands and making more agricultural lands available, making space for the growth of for the new population. Egyptian agriculture before the war as well, we had, this is a mistake here, 27 million loaves of bread consumed daily. I mean produced and consumed, not 27,000, 27 million. 20 million tons of crops consumed in a year. So this is the amount, the quantity Egypt uses in a year. It is divided as follows. We have so-called local production can meet only 40% of the local demand, and that is the focal point of the problem. There are two types of breads in Egypt. There is the subsidized bread, which is subsidized by the government, of course. It used 3.5 million tons of local crops. This ensures the quantity for 5 months. And there is the other 7 months are being guaranteed by the imported imported wheat. 13.1 million tons of crops have been imported in 2021. Subsidized bread used 5.1 million tons of imported crops, and 8 million were used for the non-subsidized bread. Just to note that the price of the non-subsidized bread increased about 50% now compared to the situation on the 24th of February, the night of the when the war began. Wheat reserves as well decreased. Now it's been increasing again, but it decreased in March and even in April, so from 4 months in early March to about 2.6 months in early April. Now it will start increasing because now they are collecting the wheat, and I think the season was very good now in Egypt. The higher cost of corn, and this is another problem, the higher cost of corn used for fodder is fueling inflation in the prices of meat and farmed fish, and these problems will emerge to the surface, I think, in the following months. Right now, what the Egyptian population feels of all this is not that much because the shortages and the lack of raw material are very well restricted right now to the military part of this. So right now for the food and food security is for today it is not in danger, but I don't know what's going to happen in a couple of months. I think there will be serious problems if the measurements will not be taken correctly. Egypt has a strategic stock of meat for 9.5 months and poultry for 6.5 months. This is an important data because if any shortages or food problems will emerge, it will be by the end of the year or the beginning of 2023. Unsubsidized bread price, I said, increased by 50%. The inflation rate was 14.9% in April, up from 12.1% in March. Egypt's foreign exchange reserve declined by $4 billion. And I would like to add here one thing, that the Arab Gulf countries pumped some money in the Egyptian economy. Up to $37 billion at the end of March. Sorry, so the annual state spending of imports will nearly double because of this conflict. Now, one of the most problems Egypt faces is the devaluation of the Egyptian pound. This is an issue related to the inflation we see in the United States of America. So because of inflation in the USA, the Fed is raising interests on US bonds and in US assets. This is a very big problem for Egypt because the investors are escaping from the more risky assets to the more stable assets provided, for example, by the USA. We know that investors left the US after 2008 because the interests on American assets and bonds were almost zero. So that's why their search for the market. And Egypt was a very good market. It was a growing market, a developing market, and a lot of international and a lot of foreign investors found what they're looking for in Egypt. The investments were climbing up throughout in the last decade in Egypt, the foreign investments, but now the foreign investors are moving out of Egypt. This is a problem, and this is a very serious problem, because most of the mega projects the Egyptian government has implemented or is implementing now highly rely on foreign investments. So what can the Egyptian government do in this case? So, for example, there is something the Islamic type of stock of bonds and shareholders, I think the Egyptian government has the intention to implement this by the early summer. This means that any investor who invests in a project takes part of this, owns the part of the project according to the investments he made. He takes no interest directly according to Islamic rules, but he will profit from the project. So the risk of this is that if the project is a dead end, so the investor will lose. If the project is a bonus, it's good, and he wins, so he gains money. And this is an important measure to attract the investments from the Gulf countries. So the government, but that's another issue. I don't think that I have time to explain this in details. The government set a cap on the price of unsubsidized bread. This was one of the measurements. Egypt banned the export of wheat, flour, rice, pasta, oils, and beans for 3 months. Prohibition of selling to third parties without permission. Here I would like to add one more detail, is that every company dealing with wheats or cultivating wheats should serve 60% of its production, 60% at least, to the government. The government has the intention of raising its storage from 3.5 million to up to 6 million tons. So everyone who doesn't serve 60% of his production to the government will face sanctions. Okay. So import diversification measures. There is an agreement with India in importing 500,000 tons of wheat up till the end of the year. But as we have heard in the news, that India banned the export of wheat, but this doesn't count for Egypt because the deal with Egypt has been hit before banning of the Indian government the export of wheat. So plan to increase the area, the cultivated area in Egypt. What is the conclusion? The war has not ended. The effects are evolving. Saudis, Qataris, and UAE pledged to pour billions of dollars into the Egyptian economy. Egypt, in my opinion, is too big to fail. Egypt's stability is key for the MENA regions. I don't think that anybody will take the risk of letting Egypt go alone and fail. There is a need for support of MENA and African countries' food security. Crop producers other than Russia and Ukraine started to increase their production, like India, Canada, Australia, Argentina, and surely they will provide, with time, they will provide Egypt with more imports, with more commodities of these. And Egyptian crop production is expected to rise 8.9% in 2022, according to the American Ministry of Agriculture. Egypt is looking to cultivate food sovereignty at the national level, more land reclamation projects, more water usage from the Nile. So, as a conclusion, I would like to say one more sentence, please, if you allow me, that the long-term solution for Egypt is really getting food sovereignty or reducing its liability on the global market. Egypt has really three objectives right now. The first objective is more arable lands, more places to cultivate, more food. Second one is more space for the growing population. And the third objective is reducing the cost of imports, because right now Egypt is importing $15 billion a year. This is a huge amount of money. So if the first two objectives are met, Egypt will be able to reduce its import by about 30%, from 15 to 10 billion, and it will be on the right track on obtaining food sovereignty. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great honor and pleasure to be here again and to be here in person after COVID-19. In my presentation, I would like to introduce the international development work of the Hungarian Charity Service of the Order of Malta, and mainly focus on our latest micro-level complex research that we conducted during last summer about one of our sanitation facilities within Kibera. The aim of the whole research was to measure the effects it has on the local community. But first of all, let me briefly introduce the organization itself. The Hungarian Charity Service of the Order of Malta is a Christian-based organization that aims to reduce human suffering and help the most vulnerable. Today, more than 8,000 volunteers and 4,500 employees take care of 13,000 people a day. The Hungarian Malta isn't only the biggest aid organization in Hungary dealing with international development project, but it has the longest past as well, as it was established in 1989 as one of the first NGOs in Hungary. During our work, we primarily focus on Hungary and the Hungarian inhabited areas of the Carpathian Basin. However, we are deeply committed to help wherever it's necessary, within our capacities, of course. So today, we have projects in 15 countries all over the world, from South America to Southeast Asia. Within Africa, we have projects in three countries, namely Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania. Almost all of these projects are sanitation projects within urban slums. And now, let me introduce you one of our projects within Kibera, which is situated in Nairobi. Kibera, considered to be the biggest slum in Africa. According to the latest census, more than 250,000 people live there. The slum is characterized by extremely bad hygienic conditions, as almost every urban infrastructural systems and services are absent, like solid waste management, plumbing, or sewer. The biggest health threat in Kibera is the lack of clean and healthy water, and consequently, there is a great and major risk of epidemics. In order to improve living conditions there, the Hungarian Charity Service of the Order of Malta built a sanitation facility in 2012. It is called Joliland Sanitation Facility, which was renovated in 2015. This approximately 60 square meter center provides local community with potable water and hygienic toilets and showers as well. To accurately see the effects of this facility that it has on local community, we implemented a micro-level complex research during last summer, and we had four research questions. The two of them were about the wider context of the facility in order to get a detailed picture about the living condition of locals. And the last two questions were about the sanitation facility itself. In order to get the answers, we elaborated four research tools. However, on the field, only three of them were used due to different reasons. When we determined the scope of the research, we had to take into account our capacities. Therefore, at the end, the sample size was determined in 100 questionnaires and 10 in-depth interviews with local residents. Next step was the exact geographical determination of the research area. The reason is that there are a lot of sanitation centers within Kibera today. However, we wanted to measure the effect of the Joliland facilities, so it was necessary to conduct the research within the direct catchment area of the facility. So this area was first delimited by a Voronoi polygon. However, that area would have been too small to cover the 100 questionnaire samples, so we needed to extend it a little bit. And that's how we get this almost triangular shaped 44,000 square meter area. The location of the questionnaires were defined by random sampling. Based on the database of OpenStreetMaps, we randomly picked 100 plus 20 backup buildings. We needed the backups for cases if the originally picked houses weren't residential homes. So it can be said that our sample is representative. During the research, we closely cooperated with our Kenyan partner, Natural Capital Trust, a Kenyan NGO. And on the field, we had 10 research assistants who implemented the questionnaires and recorded the data in Excel files, so we got the results in a digital format. Meanwhile, I was doing the interviews. And it can be said that it was a very complex research, so it covered lots of areas of life. Therefore, I won't be able to talk about all of the issues like demographic background, migration motivation, household data, sanitation, health, and so on. I would like to highlight only the most important and the most relevant aspects. First, it's very important to talk about the residents themselves. It can be said that most of local people are tenants, so 89% of Kiberans pay rental fees for the shacks they live in. And another important attribute of local residents is that mostly they are immigrants, so only 17% of the local residents were born within Kibera. However, other people moved from other parts of the country or from other parts of the city. As they are immigrants, it's an important question to ask that what was the reason, why did they leave their original homes? And for that question, the most common answer given by 86% was lack of job opportunities at homes. So we had several other questions related to the migrational motivation and background. And in conclusion, it can be said that a typical life path is that due to lack of job opportunities in countryside, a lot of people move into urban slums in order to find a job, to make ends meet, and to support their families, who in most cases stay or remain in their rural homes. In case of Kibera, it doesn't necessarily mean that they work within Kibera, but in practice, this is the most common case. However, Kibera provides them with affordable housing within a city, where they are more likely to find a job than at a rural area. And staying in Kibera is a very important thing, but it's only a temporary stopover in their lives. In most of the cases, in an older age, almost everyone wants to move back to their rural homes. We wanted to get a clear picture about local residents' opinion about the Kibera itself. So we asked them to name three things they like about the slum and three things they don't like about it. And it can be said that the number one positive factor of Kibera is affordability. It means affordable housing on one hand, but on the other hand, it also means affordable commodities because prices are significantly cheaper within the slum than at the other places within Nairobi. The second most common answer was good relationship with neighbors. It is very important because in absence of social safety net, is the community's solidarity is essential for getting along. And the third positive factor of Kibera is the proximity to jobs, but I've already told about it. So we can turn to the challenges. It can be said that based on the responses, the greatest challenge in Kibera is sanitation, then water. And of course, these two factors are closely interrelated. And the third most common answer to this question was public safety. However, as our project has water and sanitation profile, I would like to talk about these two issues a little bit in detail. Getting clean and healthy water within Kibera is a very challenging thing, as most of the houses don't have direct connection to the water system, so the water has to be fetched outside of the homes. Today, there are a lot of opportunities to do so, as you can see in these pictures, for example, getting water at water kiosks. However, a more important question to ask is that where does the water come from? In Kibera, it can be said that the main source of water is the Nairobi Water and Sewerage Company that built water pipes into Kibera and connected water taps to it. So the company provides safe water to local residents. However, in many cases, unfortunately, we can find private providers who connect illegally to these water points or get the water from boreholes. The main problem with illegal connections is that the water is transported through plastic pipes, which can be easily damaged, and in this case, the dirt of the street extremely contaminates the water. And boreholes can be a good solution. However, in a lot of cases, it can be a threat as well when the water isn't adequately tested or when the borehole itself isn't deep enough. We wanted to get a clear picture about water sources, so we asked local residents that where do you get the water from? And it can be said that in most of the cases, people buy water at water kiosks. Only 3% buy it from water vendors, and there was only one case who mentioned borehole as the primary water source. The fact that no one mentioned river as a source of water, it's a very, very encouraging thing, because a decade ago, picture was very different. As a decade ago, there wasn't any officially built water pipe within Kibera, so the vast majority of the people had to get the water from the nearby dam, where the water is extremely contaminating, so it could spread typhoid and cholera. So it's a huge development. And during our interviews, locals told us that water should always be boiled first before use, no matter where they obtained it from. So this means that even though the water supply has improved significantly, so there are a lot of opportunities to buy it, and the quality has improved somewhat with the decline in the use of water from the river, it can be said that safe, healthy drinking water is still in short supply. And now let me talk a little bit about sanitation. Today, there are lots of sanitation facilities and public toilets within Kibera, so the vast majority of people are able to use normal toilets instead of open defecation or the so-called flying toilet. This is the situation when a toilet is replaced by a plastic bag, then thrown away. And within our research, we focused on Joliland facility, as we were very keen about the opinion of the users, and based on the responses, it can be said that 1/3 of the whole sample has direct experience with Joliland facilities, so 1/3 of the respondents use the facility. We asked a lot of questions regarding the facility from them, and I would like to highlight only two of these questions. First, we asked them that what effect does it have on your life, and what's the reason for that? And we are very glad that based on the results, it can be said that the facility has positive or very positive effect on local communities' life. The main reason for that is that the facility made the environment cleaner, so there are no flying toilets or significantly less flying toilets on the streets nearby the facility. That's one factor. And the other factor is that it provides better health condition through potable water and hygienic toilet and showers. Although there were two cases when respondents said that it has negative effect on their lives, and the reason for that is the sanitation facility makes the environment dirtier. So just to finish my presentation, I would like to show you our four original research questions, and I would like to answer only the two that are related directly to the sanitation facility. So the conclusion of our research is that the Jolinland sanitation facility has significant and positive effect on local communities' lives, and it plays an important role in meeting their everyday needs. Access to water has improved, and the neighborhood has become cleaner. And it can be said that users are almost satisfied. However, it's important to mention that there is some dissatisfaction regarding the hygienic condition of the sanitation facility, which is a very useful reflection to us. So the proper maintenance is an important factor in improving the living condition of local residents. However, during the physical or technical condition survey, we revealed a major problem that threatens the sustainable operation of the facility, namely that the water pipe of the center has been cut through during a construction, a huge highway construction within Kibera, so therefore a necessary amount of water isn't provided now. And in order to handle this major problem, we initiated a project in a nearby school called Mashimoni Squatter School, where we intend to drill a borehole and supply the water from there to Jolinland facility, but that is a topic to another presentation. So for this time, I would like to thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much for your interesting and really challenging presentation, and my special appreciation for the excellent time management, which enables us to have 3 minutes more for comments and questions. So while I highly appreciate to you and your colleague, it is really a very important issue because it is not a Kenyan phenomenon. Such slum areas, even personally I saw in many other African countries, but not only in Africa. From India to Latin America you can find such. And I think the reason is very similar in every country concerned, that people give up farming because they don't have machinery, they don't have loan, they don't have capital, they don't have infrastructure, and they are wandering to the proximity of the big cities. They just dare to hope they will have a better livelihood. And as you mentioned, the majority of people in an elderly age, they are just moving back. Well, can it be a very sad story or not, but it is a fact, and it is really very very good that from the Hungarian charity organizations, I think you are pioneers. So congratulations, and we wish you much success to such an activity, and I'm waiting the questions from the offline participant. Yes, Professor Marsai, please.
Thank you very much. Welcome, everybody. My name is Viktor Marsai, and I have a question to Professor Rashid. So, Rashid, my question is that since the beginning of the war in Ukraine, there is this constant discussion about this food security and the effects. And my question is that how do you see, in general, Egypt can manage it and without big riots or problems? Because now almost 3 months is over, and for me it seems that in spite of the price shock, Egypt managed to utilize its strategic reserves. It managed to diversify its import. So my impression is that actually strong and stable countries as Egypt, or we can mention even Tunisia or other countries, Turkey, even they are the biggest importers, can manage these issues. And the real challenge in the world system is for these fragile states and conflict zones, which are not possible to cope with the increasing food prices and the effects of the lack of wheat, oil, etc., etc. So how do you see it?
Thank you very much. Yes?
Connecting question, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Yes. So thank you very much for a very interesting talk. You, at the very end of it, started to list a couple of plans, yeah, in terms of having more arable land, having more land in general for, you know, the population with that huge boom and growth. So what about the involvement, the potential involvement, and the Egyptian government plans about that, really, in their manifestations, the potential involvement of the external actors contributing to, you know, more cultivation and therefore contributing to food security, but in the context, as you said, food sovereignty. So, you know, yes, contributing, but of course managed by the Egyptian, you know, yes, actors.
Yes, thank you very much. Professor Marsai, thank you for the question, first of all, because this is a very significant question. And really, it needs to be answered, or at least we try attempt to answer such an important question. First of all, the question, will Egypt be able to manage these things and to prevent things from being unmanageable? I think, as I said, Egypt is too big to fail, or we can say too big to fall. The problem in this is connected to Professor Tarosh's question. So both questions are connected, and I would like to answer both of them in one statement. Yes, I think that on the long term, the problem is a long term problem. On the short term, Egypt will be able to deal with this issue. As I said, there are crop reserves. Right now, we have about 3 months, and there's a 3 month reserves in Egypt, maybe a little bit more, but in April it was 2.6 month reserves. And the cultivation this year and the production this year is very good. It's almost 10% more than last year. I think this year Egypt will not face any food shortages. The question is how long the war will continue. So it's the time that doesn't play for Egypt. We have another problem facing Egypt. It's the problem of the Ethiopian dam. And we shouldn't forget the original problem is the water problem. And one of the major aspects of this problem is the GERD, the Great Ethiopian Renaissance Dam. The problem, I met a lot of Egyptian officials, and some of those were present in the negotiations between the Egyptian and the Ethiopian party in Washington in February 2020. And they say that the Egypt's problem is not the dam itself, but the system of dams Ethiopia will build in the future behind the big dam. So they want a deal which covers everything. Ethiopia, of course, doesn't want that. So this is a pending problem. Right now, Egypt gets about 60 million. The consumption, the annual consumption of water in Egypt is about 60 billion cubic meter per year. 55.6 billion of this come from the Nile. So that's the core problem. How will Egypt manage this on the long term? And let's not forget that it's almost July. And July is the filling period of the reservoir behind the Great Renaissance Dam. So Ethiopia is planning to fill fill maybe about 5-10 billion cubic meters in the reservoir, which will cause this year will cause shortages in Egypt if Ethiopia manages to fill them. So all these problems are collected together, and on top of everything, this food problem, this wheat problem. I think food shortages will not be present this year. Through big projects and through long-term projects, Egypt will be capable of solving these problems. But I think the Egyptian government's plan is now one problem at a time. So they are very short-sighted. They are planning for short periods now. But there are also the big plans. The big plans, as I said, we have four big projects. The Sinai project, the new Delta project, the Toshka project, and there is the fourth one, which is the greenhouses, 100,000 greenhouses. So these altogether cost about $100 billion. This is a huge amount of money. But if Egypt, with the Arabic, the Gulf governments, the Gulf states, could reach a kind of an investment cooperation in this project, I think Egypt will be able to solve its problem on the long term. There is one more important thing here is that the private sector. What about the private sector and what about the foreign investors and the contractors who would like to conduct projects in Egypt? Yeah, the big thing in Egypt is that the military controls everything. So if you want to be involved in a big project, you have to talk to the military. So the military takes the project and spreads it and distributes it to contractors, private contractors. But the military supervises everything. Officially, Egyptian government says the military is not involved in more than 50% of the projects, but this is only the official statement, I think. There are information, unofficial information, that the military is involved in all big matters in the state, if not directly, in an indirect manner. Let's say, for example, transportation. Transportation doesn't belong officially to the military, but the minister of transportation is a former general. So let's. In fact, the thing is that in Egypt, the previous senior officers have low pensions, low wages. So this is a kind of compensation from the government to the military actors, to the actors of the military sector who are now on pension. So they take such big contracts and projects. I think this is a very good thing because the military supervises everything. It means that it's a less chance for the projects to fail, so they are very centralized. Yes, Egypt attracts a lot of money, investments, but the challenges today in case of foreign investments are very big. The problem is the inflation worldwide. And as just a final statement for the answer, I think that yes, Egypt will manage this problem. There will not be similar events like what happened in 2011. I don't think that there will be any other Arabic Spring. It has also social reasons because nobody wants that term oil again that happened 10 years ago. So it's much cheaper, and I think it's much beneficial if they put their confidence in the government, and the government has its tools, I think, in solving this problem.
When we go back to the food supply issue, I just remember 12 years ago already I had a privilege to interpret between the Egyptian and the Hungarian agricultural minister. And even that time it was on the agenda that Hungary can supply cereals or wheat flour and similar items to Egypt. Do you think that Hungary can make a benefit from this situation? Can Hungary at least partially fill this huge looking gap in the Egyptian food import?
Of course, in the sense of herds and animals, there has been discussions. Yes. There has been talks about that, but I think that the Hungarian production is too small for the Egyptian market right now. So they can fill a small corner, but I don't think that Hungary has the capability, and Hungary has the ability to be to play a major role in solving Egypt's food problems. So Hungary can be an additional partner, maybe, but the production of Hungary is too small for Egypt. And just I would like to highlight one thing, that in 1997, when the Toshka project, we're talking about the Toshka project, is a very big project. Of course, it failed, but they say that it can be successful. The Toshka project, when they launched this project in 97, the population of Egypt was 64 million. Now, the population of Egypt is 106 million, 42 million additions.
Professor Solomon.
Yeah, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Rashid, for very
thank you.
Informative presentation. Anyways. We are in the academia. We don't need to talk about like Ethiopian, Egyptian politicians. So we can calm it down. I mean, what I found a bit problematic is the dam. we shouldn't really mystify the dam. It is a hydroelectric power dam. And, you know, the water hits the turbines and they go. And I also haven't heard or haven't known. I mean, in Ethiopia, we don't know if the Ethiopian government has other dams, other series of dams behind the Grand Ethiopian dam. And last two rounds of filling the dam, somehow also assisted by nature, honestly. You know, we were also thinking that, you know, the impression was that the dam was going to be filled during July, the whole of July and August. No, just a few, not more than 1 week rains, I mean, when the rain is abundant, not more than 1 week of rain was needed to fill 5 billion or 7 billion. Also, we shouldn't really overestimate the capacity of the dam and the government's capacity to hold water. You know, if the dam is still under construction, if they fill, for example, the third round, this rain season, unless there is going to be really a shortage of rain, I don't think there will be much. So I think it is important also to promote discussions among academia, public diplomacy, workers where, you know, the Ethiopian public and the Egyptian public do understand together. And also, to be honest, the government of Ethiopia, especially the current one, I'm not a supporter of the government, they are conscious that, you know, the drive is not to really hold the water, just to use it, you know, to generate some electricity. So I felt, you know, that, you know, some alarmist kind of perspectives can be avoided, but at the same time, all of us can continue to engage constructively. Yes. Thank you.
Let me just add one sentence to this. Yeah. I used to have an Egyptian and an Ethiopian PhD students. Both of them graduated last year. Yeah. And my dream was to make a paper together jointly about this issue. Yeah. But I achieved a lot in my life, but I couldn't achieve this to find a common nominator between them. Slowly.
Yes, I would like to just comment in one sentence to our colleague. So thank you very much for this very important remark regarding the filling of the dam and the attitude inside the Ethiopian community towards the dam. It's not merely a political issue. It is an environmental issue, because I understand and everyone should understand the need of Ethiopia for such a dam and to improve its infrastructure, to improve its electricity network, and so on. So there is no question about that. The question is about Egypt itself. So the existence of Egypt has been relied on the Nile for thousands of years. And you cannot change this through one night. So Egypt cannot change or cannot diversify its water supplement or cannot take any measures within few couple of years to avoid shortage of water and to avoid the collapse of agriculture in the country. And we know if there is shortage in water, so Ethiopia didn't fill that big amount in the reservoir yet, so that it didn't cause any problems for Egypt right now. But I know that Ethiopia would not like to extend this filling for decades. Ethiopia wants to function the dam as soon as, because it costs a lot of money, and Ethiopia has contracts, and Ethiopia should deliver electricity. But on the other hand, the problem is with the Egyptian situation. So it's not the fault of Ethiopia. It's the problem inside Egypt, And unwillingly, Ethiopia is contributing to the problem by this dam. So this is the Egyptian point of view. We are not against the dam, but come on, let's sit down and find a common common solution between each other. And I think if we inside the academia, we enhance this, this will be beneficial for everybody. Thank you.
One very short question from Professor Tim and one very short answer from Professor Rashid.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
I wish I was a professor, but thank you. Thanks for a very, very interesting presentation. I actually have two short questions, one for Ms. Syriac as well, as she's still here, yeah. Mm. But first, perhaps to you, Prof, and you must excuse, and I will reveal all my theoretical leanings. I'm doing critical political economy, and critical political economists, they always want to dig a little bit deeper. Yes. So, I mean, on the one hand side, the global food system or the global food systems are, ethically speaking, flawed, to call it the least. Yes. So I am wondering now, you started with the conceptualization of food security, and zooming out from Egypt now, on a more global level, because with climate change, we will have these issues all over, particularly in the so-called Global South. Yes. So now I wanted to know from you as the expert, because I'm not familiar with food security and also not with the global food markets. I just consider them ethically screwed. Do you think we should work also on the definition of food security again? You spoke about accessibility.
Yes.
Do we perhaps need a geographical element to it? Do we need to consider to deglobalize global food systems? I'm very interested in your views on this. And again, I revealed all my leanings. You know where I stand, and I accept any other position. And then to Ms. Syriac, that's very short, actually. And I don't know if you wanna reveal that in terms of your data composition, but I was just wondering about the religious composition of this compound that you have investigated. Was that relatively coherent, or were there different religious groups? And could you did you survey their religious membership or affiliation? And were there differences in the answers?
So
thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me answer very briefly the first question. It was a very significant question as well, and I'm not a global food security expert. I'm just working on the Egyptian and the MENA region. I think that, but in my opinion, I think we cannot say that we should deglobalize the food supply, and it is impossible to deglobalize it in a globalized world. I think the best solution, in my opinion, is for each country to produce more than 50% of its needs locally. So to reduce the global, the dependence of each country on the global market to less than, let's say, 40%, 30%. So almost minimum, at least more than 50% of the food should be produced inside the given country, so that if any global earthquake happens or any global disaster hits, like what we have now in Russia and Ukraine, so most of the countries will not be vulnerable that much, and we will not see any famine issues. So it's really very dangerous, so that if you are totally reliable on the export market, on the global market, if anything happens, there will be famine within months. So I think the solution is to produce more than 50 or 60% of the food locally. This is for each country.
Thank you.
Thank you for the questions. During our research, we asked about the religions of local residents, and the picture is very heterogeneous within Kibera. So there are 13 villages within Kibera, but the population is totally heterogeneous from perspective of religion and tribe. But talking about the Joliland facility itself, when we work on the field, first we try to find a partner. and in this case an owner who will operate the sanitation facility on the long run, because of course we are working in Hungary, so we cannot be there to do the things on the field. And in case of Jolinand facility, the owner and the operator of the sanitation facility is a CBO, community-based organization, Jolinand, and they are Nubians, so they are Islamic. However, in close vicinity to the sanitation facility, a lot of Christians live as well, so they use the sanitation facility as well, so there isn't any tension between Muslims or Christians within Kibera, which is a great thing from our perspective and from everyone's.
Thank you very much, Rahel. I am really happy, but not surprised at all, that these two presentations generated quite a number of questions. But unfortunately, we are behind our time schedule, so I immediately give the floor to Professor Marsai, and the panel number 3 starts now. Thank you very much.